sport of race walking lives among the people on the streets and roads of the world. The action of a race walker is a light but vigorous step. In it, we can see the unique demands of the discipline, harmony of movement, the acceptance of fatigue, and even pain. The origins of race walking stretch back to the great pedestrian challenges of the 18th and 19th centuries. The discipline, as we now know it, first appeared in the 1906 Olympic Games, where competitions were held for men only over the relatively short distances of 1500 and 3000 meters. In the last 100 years, the official championship distances have evolved, and currently, the men walk 20 and 50 kilometers in international competitions. International level competition for women started with a 5,000 meters race at the 1979 World Cup in race walking. The competition distance has evolved since then, and the current championship distance of 20 kilometers was first used at the 1999 World Championships in Athletics in Seville. Race walking is governed by IAAF Competition Rule 230. Paragraph 1 of the rule describes the discipline as a progression of steps so taken that the walker makes contact with the ground so that no visible, to the human eye, loss of contact occurs. The advancing leg shall be straightened, that is, not bent at the knee, from the moment of first contact with the ground until the vertical upright position. Race walking is a technical discipline. An understanding of the correct technique is essential for learning an action that both complies with Rule 230 and enables the walker to reach a high level of performance. The action of the race walker can be divided into two parts: the main movements and the supporting movements. The main movements, those of the lower body, propel the walker forward. The supporting movements are those of the trunk and arms, and they balance the body as it advances. good race walking technique requires a step that is oriented forward and allows the walker to proceed straight and fast. In the single support phase, the knee of the leg in contact with the ground must be completely extended. In accordance with the rules, the extension of the knee is maintained from the moment the heel touches the ground until the leg reaches the vertical upright position. To make the action as effective as possible, the extension should be maintained until the end of the stride and the foot has pushed off from the ground. The swing phase applies to the non-support or swinging leg. It is characterized by the bending of the knee and the forward movement of the knee and foot. As they move forwards, the foot grazes the ground and the knee stays low, passing the knee of the support leg at approximately the same level. The swing phase ends at the moment the heel of the swinging leg contacts the ground and the knee is completely extended. The double support phase is the moment when both feet are in contact with the ground. In this position, we can measure the length of the stride from the heel of the front foot to the toe of the rear foot. The duration of the double support phase depends on the speed of the walker, but it is very short, only a few milliseconds. By drawing an imaginary vertical line dividing the walker's body in two, we can see that the rear leg has a greater angle of force than the front leg. This allows a longer acceleration and reduces the braking at the moment the heel of the front leg makes ground contact. The movement of the race walker is characterized by an exaggerated hip movement. Both correct technique and the speed of the walker depend on this movement. Good hip action reduces the inefficient raising and lowering of the center of mass with each step, and thus the center of mass moves forward along a horizontal line. Within a complete movement cycle, the hips make a circular motion of 360 degrees. The completeness of the motion is very important, as it contributes to a correct race walking action and allows the walker to move forward fluidly with a low energy cost. To maintain the walker's balance and support the main movements propelling the body forward, the action of the arms must be harmoniously synchronized with the stride. The flexed position of the elbows should be maintained constantly. And the shoulders should remain relaxed to facilitate the fluid movement of the arms. Thank you. The trunk should be straight but not rigid. For the most economical movement, it should be inclined slightly forward when the back leg is pushing, and it should be vertical during the single support phase. The position of the neck and head should be natural and relaxed in order to avoid any kind of tension in the movements of the shoulders and arms. For the technique sequences shown in this video, we have purposely used images recorded during top-level competitions. They demonstrate how it is possible to walk correctly, even at high speed, and achieve excellent performances through a completely controlled technique. Good technique must be learned from the beginning of the walker's career and maintained as the performance level increases. It is therefore indispensable for a walker to receive the technical guidance of a qualified coach who can communicate clear, easy to understand instructions that the walker can transform into the necessary motor skills. Technique, however, must not be confused with style, which develops in accordance with the individual neurophysiological and biomechanical characteristics of the athlete. Work on technique and style involves the control of the movements in the walker's action with the help of specific exercises. Race walking competitions are usually held on road courses. The competitions are under the control of a jury of judges, led by a chief judge, whose duties include communicating a disqualification to a competitor by showing him or her a red paddle. In major national and international events, the chief judge has one or two assistants, who are positioned on the course and are entitled to communicate disqualifications to the competitors. The judges that make up the jury evaluate the walking action of the competitors, basing their judgments on their visual observations. They can warn a walker of an action that may infringe the rules by showing a yellow paddle. The paddles have symbols indicating that the possible infringement is for loss of contact with the ground or the failure to extend the knee. Each judge may warn a competitor only one time for each type of error. Continued violation of the rules is communicated from a judge to the chief judge by means of a red card sent to the recorder. When three judges submit a red card on a particular competitor, he or she will be disqualified with the red paddle, withdrawn from the race, and stripped of his or her bib number. In international competitions, walkers can be disqualified only by the decision of judges from three different countries. Competitors can check their status during the race by observing the disqualification board, which is electronic in the major international competitions and manual in events that do not have such a system. Competitors may only take refreshment in the official drinking and sponging areas. Refreshments taken outside these areas may lead to the athlete's disqualification. In races shorter than 10 kilometers, drinks are not allowed, but the competitors can use sponging areas. Racewalking courses are designed in accordance with strict rules regarding both distance measurement and the profile of the course. Generally, races must be conducted in good light conditions to facilitate the work of the judges. At major championships, the start and the finish of the racewalking course is usually on the track inside the stadium. The major international racewalking competitions include the Olympic Games, the World Championships in Athletics, Continental Championships, World and Continental Championships for various age categories, and finally, the World Cup in Racewalking, an event that is usually held completely on the road.